This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Second round of the PGA at Riviera is underway. Luke List and Jason Day co-lead at 8-under. Tiger Woods won over after his first round on Thursday.
This is the Miller's Edge with Christian Miller, two-time national champion and team captain for the Alabama Crimson Tide and former Carolina Panther, and his father, Corey Miller, the pastor of pain, a 9-year NFL veteran with the New York Giants and University of South Carolina Hall of Famer. This is the Miller's Edge.
Friday edition of the Miller's Edge here on the Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC. Welcome in, everybody. Hope you are ready for the weekend. It's going to be a beautiful weekend, and of course, we're here to get you ready to rock and roll. Going to be a lot of good stuff happening there in the city of Tuscaloosa. What a great sports weekend. If you're an Alabama fan, you're right there with baseball, you got softball, you got basketball. Man, it is going to be locked and loaded for a wonderful weekend of college athletics there in Tuscaloosa. And we're looking forward to that. Of course, we're going to talk about a lot of that here on the program today. 205-342-9904 is the number for the show. Please get in line, get your calls in. And if you're at work trying to hire from your old boss, well, you know what you can do. Download that app. Tide 100.9 is absolutely free, and you can send your questions and thoughts, comments right there. We love to entertain those each and every single day. Of course, we call it free-for-all. It's wherever you want to go today, whatever you want to talk about. I don't care if it's sports. I don't care if it's music. I don't care everything, anything but politics. Don't do that. Bingo. Anything else? We can ride. We like ABP, anything but politics. Other than that, we can ride. So we got you on that front. We're here from Ryan Grubb, the former offensive. That sounds so strange to say. The former offensive coordinator of Alabama, now Seattle Seahawks offensive coordinator. We'll hear some of his thoughts and comments about being there in Seattle and about leaving the Tide in a very quick departure. So he has some thoughts on that, his relationship with Kellen DeBoer. I listened to some of that earlier. So we'll hear from him. We'll talk about one Eldrick Tiger Woods is on the course, finished plus one on yesterday. Of course, a tough number 18, second, had a great drive, second shot looked like me, just flared right, got in trouble behind the tree, but hit a nice shot with a chance to save par, end up bogeying that hole, and ended up being plus one for the tournament. So I love to hear what you think about Tiger. What's his chances? Because he walked better than I've ever seen him walk, looked better than I've ever seen him look in the last couple of years, to be honest with you. And I've been one that on record saying Tiger Woods going to win another major or two. I do believe that. It's going to happen. It's going to be Augusta National. It's probably going to be the British Open. I think Tiger's going to be that guy. Might be when he's in his early 50s. And we've seen people do that before. So I think Eldrick Tiger Woods will be on the prowl. And he will win another couple of majors. Don't know when that's going to be, but I'm going to say the next couple of years, he's definitely going to win. The guy works so hard. I love what he did with his swing. He slowed it down a lot, not so aggressive attacking the ball. So we can talk some golf. I'm a huge golf fan, play a lot of golf. So if you want to talk about that, we can get into some of that as well. Love to get your thoughts, comments, or questions about Tiger Woods. Will he win another major. God, I don't have a whole lot today. I thought we'd just have some fun. Yep. Friday's what it's all about. Get you ready for the weekend. Laugh, joke, cut up. Don't matter. Not a whole lot of stuff going on, Christian. I guess the biggest thing, Alabama basketball team back at home. Early game, it seems to be.
Yep.
First place solo by themselves. South Carolina just getting obliterated, by Auburn the other night. 101-60, I believe, by 41 points. I mean, what in the world? We know that place they play in, that little tiny arena, but it's very imposing. But, man, they look great. So, Alabama controlled their own destiny. Now, the schedule's not easy going to finish out the season. We know that. But Alabama sit there and they know this basketball team controls their own destiny. So, that's probably the biggest thing that's happening for the Tide sports world right now.
Yeah, definitely that. Tomorrow at 11, I'll probably be there. Definitely weird that it's early here, but I'll make sure I go check it out. I'm excited for that. But I am excited. Baseball's back. It will, you know, open things up this afternoon at the Joe. I think it's at 4 o'clock, I believe. They'll be playing, is it Manhattan College? So, yeah.
Tough opponent.
Yeah, right. But just exciting that, you know, baseball's back. And then, again, softball's here. So, I mean, yeah, you already said it, a loaded weekend here in Tuscaloosa, but it'll be fun. Softball takes on Virginia, I believe, this afternoon as well. And that is at 6:30, I see. But I think first they start off at 4 against St. Thomas, and then they play Virginia at 6:30. So, yeah, if you're in Tuscaloosa or you're an Alabama fan, make sure you head on over to one of these athletic events because it's filled. But make sure you come correct, and you got to go by Alumni Hall to get your latest and greatest officially licensed Alabama gear. So make sure you're geared up for all these big events, whether it's a hat, hoodie, polo, you name it. They've got it right there in Midtown Village at Alumni Hall. If you're not local, no worries. You can always go to alumnihall.com and order whatever you like. They got the 2 for $30 deals on tees. They got baseball jerseys, all type of jerseys. Make sure you go check them out now. Again, that's Alumni Hall, alumnihall.com, or the Ultimate Crimson Tide Fan Shop. You know, another thing I was going to mention to you is former Alabama quarterback A.J. McCarron. I think this was like yesterday, maybe the day before.
Yeah, I was just reading that. St. Louis Battlehawks.
Yeah, but check this out, though, because remember, he was playing with the Battlehawks last year. He got signed by the Bengals, right? Mm-hmm. He got signed by the Bengals midway through the season, or, you know, towards the end of the season, whenever it was, back on the practice squad. And you know, I mean, as a backup quarterback, you're making good money in the NFL, but he requested to be released by the Bengals so he could rejoin the St. Louis Battlehawks. And I don't know if you remember last season, but he actually talked about how appreciative he was for the Battlehawks.
He's highest paid, though, in that league, too, right?
I think he probably was the highest paid. And he was probably one of the highest performers. I was looking at Ryan Fowler's tweet, and he set an XFL record throwing 24 touchdowns. He led the league with 68.8%. completion rate, ranked second with 203 completions, had 2150 passing yards. So that being said, he had an interview where he talked about how appreciative he was just to be able to play, right? And I know we talk about, you know, being a backup quarterback in the league is one of the best gigs you can have because you're getting paid so much money to hold a clipboard and just sling the ball around at practice. But he embraces playing football, and I think he knows. He's starting to get up there. I actually ran into him. Forgot what game it was he was in attendance for this year, and I was calling the game on the sideline. I spoke to him briefly, and I asked him kind of what his plans were, and he said, yeah, man, he still wants to play. So, basically what he was saying was he enjoys that his kids get to see their dad play football, right? And if he's, you know, in that backup role at Cincinnati, he's in the National Football League, but his kids don't really get the luxury to see him go out there and really spin it, and he gets to do that with the Battlehawks, and he's been doing it at a high level, man. And I think that says a lot about him and just, you know, his passion for the game, that he'd rather go down to the UFL just so he can play football than be a backup with the Bengals. So I just was curious your thoughts. So do you think you ever would do something like that if you were in the tail end of your career? You know, you played 8-9 years in the league. I know you're laughing, but I'm saying, like, say so me and CJ could go watch you play a little bit, because you did have that comeback. You were coaching that arena team. And you suited up trying to kind of get some more fan engagement or whatever you did that for and play quarterback. But I'm saying, would you say if the XFL came calling, would you say, man, I might go suit up for the XFL or the UFL now a couple years just so my kids and my family can come actually watch me play? Because right now I'm only doing special teams duty. I'm not playing any snaps, whatever. Even that's a little bit different than a backup quarterback. Would you ever do that? Let me say you're a quarterback, because that's not a good comparison.
Yeah. I mean, playing quarterback is different, because I did that. You're right. I was a GM for Arena football team. Yeah, for folks that didn't know, here in Columbia, South Carolina. And then I did something stupid after being retired for 3-4 years that I was going to make a comeback, and the press got a hold of it just for one game, and instead of playing linebacker, which, you know, I said, I'm going to play quarterback. And so people that don't know, I mean, I could play quarterback.
Hold on now.
Who won the game? Who won the game that night?
Me. You got clean, too, dude.
That's part of the game. But I don't mind taking a hit. But you know what I'm saying? I threw 3 touchdowns that game. And I ran one in. Yeah, and we beat Jacksonville.
With ice bags all over
your body. I did. It was the worst mistake ever. I mean, but I came back just to show these quarterbacks who played college ball that I could play quarterback even in my mid-30s better than they could, because they absolutely was trash at the time. So, but it was a media, you know, it was one of those moves to get people to come out, people that came out and bought tickets and had a good time. But anyway. Well, if I was playing quarterback and I knew that, being a backup now in the league, NFL, and, you know, kids are old enough that I want to actually go out there and play, maybe. I mean, A.J. McCarron, just to give you an idea, in his years in the National Football League, made about $15 million. $15 million. Now, taxes and all, we know, whatever, still a lot of money.
Right.
The XFL pays, I believe, about $60,000.
I think he was the highest paid. You said he was over 100, I believe.
I thought, but whatever. But still, but that's a big decrease. To be fair,
that's closer. No, but I thought that until I remembered. Was he on practice squad when he was in Cincinnati?
He started on practice squad, and I think he got bumped up because of Joe Burrow injury or something. But anyway,
I'm just saying, practice squad salary has increased. I think I have to go back and look.
Absolutely.
It's probably around 200. It's a six-figure salary. No, it is, but it used to be like 100. Now I feel like it's probably closer to 200, and it's probably even more for veterans. What I'm saying is, why has got a little answer for it?
It's $12,000 per week for a total of $216,000 over 18 weeks.
That's right. See there, thank you, Wise. I was about to say, I knew it was around 200 now. So
$216,000, my God, almost $250,000 just to practice 3 days a week. That's absolutely ludicrous.
No, it's great, though, but I'm saying, so realistically,
I would put me on the practice squad for 25 years.
Yeah, dude. You think you could go and be on the practice squad?
I can go right now and take shots and get be a three tech. Y'all don't, well, you don't play no more, but people don't hit. They don't tackle. It's not physical. Yes, I could do it.
Bruh.
If I got myself in shape.
Bro, wait. Just because they limit certain contact rules in terms of how many days.
Bro, y'all not hitting. I went 3 years when you did at the panel. Y'all did nothing. There was very seldom any kind of hitting.
What are you saying?
It was thudding. There was no tackling to the ground. That was just like, you know, get in your position. If you got force, meaning you got to stay outside, cut it back, make it cut back in. Yeah, but here's the animation question.
Training camp was different now. We had some periods where we look.
Soft.
Okay. So now everything's soft now, because when he did it, it was okay. I'm not delusional. I know y'all definitely had way more physical practices. Y'all's schedule was a lot different. It was a lot more demanding physically, 100%. But you can't sit here and say, like, they're playing flag football right now.
Bro, it is. Two-hand touch.
Man, you have lost your mind. The Steelers still go full tackle. Not every team go, but that's to prevent injuries, though.
Yeah, but they can't do, but the rule, the collective bargaining rule
it
states
limits that
you can only
days,
tackle, you can go full pads. That's one day you got to be off and be nothing the next. Y'all have rules now in place.
Did you just do a whole Facebook post talking about how much arthritis and all this stuff you got after all your daughters?
Absolutely.
Visits?
Yeah, I got a lot more to go.
Why are you mad about them limiting contact and practice? Again, my thing is limit the contact.
Well, but at least I'm able to get disability for it.
They're going to be able to get disability now, too, man. It's true.
No, I'm just kidding. Listen, let me just answer this question. We've got to get a break, our first break. For the kids, maybe, if it's quarterback. But H, no. H, no. If you're talking about playing in the trenches, in the position where we're talking about hitting, and I'm going to go for $4 million or two, even a quarter of a million to $60,000, no way. Kids, y'all got YouTube. Y'all got every kind of thing now. You can watch me live. I mean, you can just sit like you're watching the game at practice, just film it. No. I don't know what A.J. McCarron is thinking.
You don't know. I thought you said quarterback's different. You don't agree with that?
I don't care. But you better make that money while you can make that money.
He wants to play, though. But he actually wants to go out there and spin
it. Well, then go beat somebody out.
Come on,
I mean, because when you're really? Playing, let's just be honest. The competition is like college and NA, like this is like SEC and NAIA.
Hold on. Now, I would not
say no.
I've talked to guys that played in the USFL.
I watched.
No, we'll ask Bo. You watch, bro. Let's ask Bo Scarborough.
I'll ask Bo. Bo's a good player playing the league, but the overall competition is SEC. Is that type of disparity?
I wouldn't say SEC NAI. I would say maybe SEC to whatever conference somebody like maybe Western Carolina. That's not NAI. That's above NAIA.
Well, he talking about like, you know.
I'm just saying. I asked Bo, and I remember he said, "No." He said, "There's some good players, and you should know this. In the NFL, you only got 53 roster spots. Now you got a higher number of guys.
I understand that.
So there's some guys that can play ball. There's just not enough room.
Signing them guys. They're signing guys that's trying to make it to the league. They're signing a guy like Ruben Foster should be in the league.
Oh, for sure.
Right. But there's a few players that can play in the league.
I'll say this. So I think the biggest drop in talent to me is the quarterbacks. Honestly, I think that's the biggest difference, in my opinion.
Yeah, so A.J. McCarron can go to the XFL and be the best player. He knows that.
Yeah, he gets to actually play. Think about it.
He's playing against JV competition.
No, but
all right, let's hit a break. Let's continue this conversation. I wouldn't do it. I'm sorry. Not one for the money and two just competition. We gotta hit a break. Wyatt has been playing that too long. We apologize. We'll continue this conversation. Love to get your thoughts. 205-342-9904 or download that free app, Tide1.
Nutrition. You can help. $50 provides a food kit to feed a family for a month. Just text the word radio to 97646.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
A very mild afternoon, a mix of sun and clouds, the high 69. Becoming cloudy tonight, the chance of a few scattered rain showers. Colder after midnight, the low 36. Tomorrow, cold and breezy, the sky mostly cloudy, the high 47. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 66 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Twelve 21. Happy Friday, everybody. We all working for the weekend. No doubt about that. Looking forward to a wonderful weekend. We're talking about XFL, former Tide, two-time national championship quarterback, A.J. McCarron, headed back to play with St. Louis. Christian asked me the question, would I have done it back in the day? The answer is an emphatic no. I wouldn't take a pay cut. Now, he's made $15 million. I mean, he's made a lot of money, basically been a backup quarterback in the NFL. That's one of the best jobs that there is in the National Football League, to be honest with you. It's a backup quarterback, you know, a clipboard guy that you chart the plays, and, you know, now you're making millions of dollars. I mean, so that's what you got to do. Or you know, you get a chance to start to get hurt, and you go in there and play four or five good games, somebody's going to sign you, and then you get a, you know, $20, $25 million contract, and you don't even have to pan out. You're good to go for life. That's just the way it works. But I would not do it. I think the competition is okay. I think that league should be for guys that is looking for an opportunity to get to the National Football League. It should be a league for an opportunity like a guy who's been on our show like Ruben Foster, that we know who's a first-round pick for the 49ers and had his situations there with a knee, you know, injuries, off-the-field stuff, whatever. To get back in the league, which I think he needs to be. He proved that last season, coming off that injury, I guess, with Washington. So that, to me, is what that league is for. Now, I know it's good for the league to get a name like A.J. McCarron that people can, you know, familiarize themselves with and say, hey, I want to go to the games. They do have a guy that can play. But they don't really want to go see guys with, you know, a bunch of no names. I mean, that's why it's great when you, if you can get a guy like an old guy, you know, that has played to play, like a Terrell Owens, like a Chad Ochocinco.
Whoa,
you know,
dudes like that.
Well, not now, but I'm just saying, you know, back in the day, to get guys kind of like that that wanted to play, and even for them, that it wasn't ready to hang up the cleats to get in there and say, okay, hey, shoot, let me go and play in this league, even though the competition is very, you know, suspect. Right. But it's still football. And you know me, I'd say all the time, I love football. I'm a purist, okay? I watch all kinds of football. I stay up and watch Pac-12 at night. I watch Washington at night. I watch Kalen DeBoer at night. I watch those games that went, that came on at 10, 10:30, went off at 2, because I love football. But, you know, good for him. I understand with his family, his kids, that's definitely honorable what he's doing. But, you know, for me to make $60,000 and I done made $15 million, say I want to play. I mean, I can just play with them in the backyard. It's about the same thing.
But okay. But let me give you this side of things. All right. He for the most part had been a backup for his career in the NFL, which is, like you said, totally fine. I mean, that's part of it. And he definitely played in you know, many games. But I'm just saying, realistically, majority of it was in that backup role. And so he's probably yearning to actually get out there and play quarterback. And that's why I'm saying, to me, it makes sense. I mean, again, let's see what year AJ is on, because I know he's
been there a while.
Yeah, he's been in the league a while. I'm just saying, realistically, for this upcoming season, so AJ's 33, so he's probably at least 9 years in the NFL. But what I'm getting at is, dude, he's been holding a clipboard most of that time. He wants to actually play football and have his kids be able to enjoy it. And look, and honestly, it seemed like he was having so much fun last year. Like, when he was playing, it seemed like he had a ton of fun. I don't blame him, because the salary of a practice squad, like Wyatt just brought up, was like $216,000. He's getting more than that $60,000 salary. So he's probably in the six-figure range. So say, we'll just say he's getting like $115,000. Say it's like $100,000 difference. I don't blame him taking a $100,000 pay cut to actually be able to play some football and have fun. Because technically, the season in the UFL also is going to end, and he could do the same thing. He could play in the UFL, and then he could get picked back up mid-season or something like that. So, anyway, I thought that was interesting, and I thought that was good for him, man. I think it is, like you said, really big for that league to have players like that. My only thing I'll disagree with you on, I know you said it needs to be a league just for guys looking for that opportunity to make the NFL, like a guy like Slade Bolden, he just ended up signing in the UFL, I believe.
Right, I like that.
Yeah, you know, a guy that, so he spent, you know, first year in Baltimore training camp, but had a good year but got hurt. Then he was not on a roster that whole year. Then this past year, he was, I think it was with Atlanta. Same kind of deal, you know, had a decent training camp, but then didn't get signed on a team. So he's going to try again, right? Guys, like, there's some guys that they're going to keep going so they get that opportunity. That's great. But at the same time, I think it also should be a league for guys that are almost on their way out as well, like you mentioned. And I think that's a good combination of it, because then you got a lot of young, hungry guys that are going for those opportunities. But you also got guys with some name and some relevancy that are kind of on their way out, and people want to go see them play. And so I think I wouldn't just say it's only that league for the young up-and-comers. I think I like the blend of both. I want more guys that are a little more familiar in that league, because I think that will drive up the viewership, and I think that'll make it a lot more entertaining, because sometimes when you're watching it and you don't know the players, you're kind of like, it's not as, you know, enticing to watch. So just wanted to bring that up. But the other thing I was going to ask you about was Michigan's defensive back. They have a safety named Keon Sapp, who entered his name in the portal. It was a pretty solid player. I think he had like two picks last year. Definitely we have holes on this roster. Caleb Downs, most notably, leaving via the transfer portal, heading to Ohio State, right? You got Malachi Moore returning. Devontae Smith, the guy's been in the program. But other than that, it's pretty much wide open. Do you think Alabama goes after a guy like this? Do you remember Courtney Morgan and several other people on this staff, I believe, have ties to Michigan? This would be a key piece. How active do you think Alabama's going to be going after a guy like Keon Sapp? I don't know if you know too much about him. I'll be honest with you. I don't know a ton about the kid, but again, He's you know, a guy with a lot of experience, has some good stats, at least, or solid stats, 28 tackles, 2 interceptions, and feels a need here. Do you see Alabama going after him?
I think Alabama needs to go after somebody like that. I don't know if he's the answer or not, or, you know, of course, the general manager, Courtney Morgan, is a guy that we need to get on the show for sure. And talk to him about, you know, I don't know, is that what they're looking for? Is that the type of corner, you know, with this new Womack defense? Is that the type of corner? Does he fit the bill, what you're trying to do defensively? So I do know they have to fill those voids. I do know that they have to go after or somebody like that to come in, and if not to be a starter, but to be a backup, to be a fifth corner, you know, whatever it may be. I think they need to try to fill that void. I think for me now, just wait to see what happens to them in the spring, what is that going to look like? And then when the portal reopens, you know, I think we get an idea of what they're going to try to do. I expect that the edge rusher, I expect that secondary is going to be on the top of the list of importance, right, of, you know, filling some voids. Because right now, you're talking about not just being a starter, but more importantly, depth.
Yeah, you definitely need depth. And this guy's like a safety. I think he's like 6'1", 6'2", like 200-pound range. So with that size, I mean, you talk about, you mentioned Kane Womack's system. He probably could play a number of roles in this defense in that secondary, you know, because he's got good length, you know, and 200 pounds, good size. So I'm sure they could probably move him around. I wouldn't be shocked if he's on Alabama's radar. We'll have to see. But as we know, in this day and age, you're going to have to be active with some NIL if you're going to pursue guys like that. You know, he just came off of winning a national championship. There's probably going to be other teams. I wouldn't be surprised if Georgia is interested as well, so we'll have to see. Why? What you got for my fuck? You got something.
I just pulled up his Michigan little bio here. He appeared in 14 games last season and made 5 starts. He started the national championship game against Washington and broke up 2 passes and had 6 total tackles in that ball game. So a little bit of film if you're interested in watching it.
Yeah, well, I'll have to go back.
Yeah, we're
going to
check that out. Well, now that tells me a little bit more. That means Kalen DeBoer is going to have a lot of familiarity with him, right? Because, yeah, you know, having to scheme a guy like that, and it seems like he played pretty daggone well against Washington in the national championship game. So that may add a little bit of something to it. And he's familiar with Kalen DeBoer's offense and who he faced in the national championship. So maybe if you're Morgan, one of the jobs of GM is getting to know guys and filling that whole situation out. I'm pretty sure they've been doing that already. Because he's a guy that seems like got the size. You want a bigger, more physical corner that can be aggressive and run defense on the outside, especially when you're playing things like cover 2. They like to play a lot of zone, you know, so your corner's going to have to be very effective in coming up and run support. So, yeah, that makes a lot more sense. I'm definitely going to watch his tape and see what I think about him. So, but we'll see. But I know they got to be pretty active. I think they got a lot of positions to fill and for depth and then even starters. So, to me, who this team is going to be will tell me a lot based on what they do when the portal opens back open.
Yeah. No, I agree.
Open back up. Excuse me. I said that wrong.
I agree. How about let's take a quick break real quick and then we come back. I'd be curious to hear what your thoughts on the Ryan Grubb interview. I also got to listen to that. Maybe we'll get Wyatt to pull that up and we can open back up with that. Because I'll be honest, after hearing him talk at the podium, kind of made it seem like that Seattle Times, Washington, or the Seattle Times, whatever it was, article, seemed like they might have been kind of stretching some things. And it made me kind of have to rethink of kind of what we initially thought. Right. I'm just saying, I mean, the response that came out of his mouth in terms of the timing and how things went down didn't really line up with that article, which we said could have been the case. That article might not have been, you know, 100% accurate. So let's take a quick timeout and then come back with the Ryan Grubb audio from his interview with the Seattle Seahawks after being named offensive coordinator. You're listening to the Miller's Edge right here on Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC. We are presented by the Good Feet Store, America's arch sport experts. Remember, if you're in any type of pain, foot pain, knee pain, back pain, go get fitted for those premium arch sports right now. Head on over to the Good Feet Store in Midtown Village. You can always go to goodfeet.com to find the nearest location to you and schedule an appointment. Again, that's Good Feet, improving the quality of people's lives 2 feet at a time. We'll be right back after a quick timeout.
365, 24/7. You'll find road and utility crews, tow trucks, law enforcement, and first responders working along Alabama's roadway.
We're making improvements and helping our communities stay connected.
We're working hard to make sure you're safe on the road. Now we need your help to make sure we're safe too.
Alabama's move over law requires you to move over a lane when you see flashing lights on the roadside. And if you can't safely move over, please slow down.
Visit drivesafealabama.org, brought to you by the Alabama Department of Transportation, Alabama Broadcasters Association, and this station.
Are you receiving unemployment? Your benefits could be at risk. Here's how you can protect yourself and your benefits. Never respond to mail notifying you of a false claim in your name. Never answer a text message asking you to verify your account. And only respond to official Alabama Department of Labor social media pages. Report fraud at labor.alabama.gov/fraud. Brought to you by the Alabama Department of Labor, ABA, and the station. The Alabama Department of Labor is an equal opportunity employer program. Auxiliary aids and services available upon request to individuals with disabilities. Dial 711 for TTY accessibility.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
And welcome back into the Miller's Edge right here on Tide 100.9, 1230 a.m. WTVC. Presented by the Good Feet Store, America's Art Sport Experts. We're talking about that Ryan Grubb interview from his press conference after being named the offensive coordinator for the Seattle Seahawks. Why do we have that pulled up? Let's hear what Ryan Grubb had to say regarding the process of being hired from Alabama. Again, he's here just several weeks, but let's hear what he had to say about being hired by the Seattle Seahawks.
You know, I thought about that process a lot of times, honestly. So I think just in the situation we're in made it tougher, just that he was getting it started out in Alabama and, you know, wanted to be there for him. But, you know, I knew this is what ultimately that I wanted to do if the right situation came up. You know, the timing is so difficult to really describe. So I think that was the hardest part, was being in that position where the timing wasn't going to be perfect. And I think in this industry, the people that are in it, you just know that the timing is never going to be perfect. So best possible scenario, you know, you'd love those timelines to marry up a little bit better. And obviously, you know, that was the hardest part, honestly. We knew this day would come for sure. And I'm excited for Kalen. I know he's going to do a phenomenal job down in Alabama. And I know he's excited for me for this opportunity.
Ryan, you had made it pretty clear that you wanted the UW job and you wanted to stay here. Had you reconciled that you were going to be in Tuscaloosa at any point in this process, that it was set that you were going to be?
Yeah, no, that was that's where I was. You know what I mean? That was really the point, was to take the job down there and be the offensive coordinator, and nothing was set here. You know, Mike was going through his process and trying to make the best decisions he could for the Seahawks, and so nothing was set, and so I had to keep moving forward with the job that I had taken, and that was the Alabama offensive coordinator job. So, yeah, I just had to trust the process and know that it would end up the right way.
That was Ryan Grubb sharing his thoughts on kind of how it all unfolded, and I thought it was interesting why, just because there was, I don't know if you, did you read that Seattle Times article, or did you see it?
Yeah, I'd read it, said that they kind of,
we're trying to wait till the window was over, that he was already on the radar.
Yeah, cooperated on that effort.
Yeah, well, and so after hearing that from him, you know, that doesn't seem like it was the case. It seems like, you know, yeah, there was interest, but, you know, he took the job here, and he fully expected to be here. And kind of like we said, you know, he was doing his job because that's where he was at, right? Nothing really was set. So that's why you always try to always hear it from the person themselves. That's why I try to be slow to just believe everything I'm reading, because to me, I'm like, that was a little, I mean, even just as a journalist putting that out there, I mean, that's a little risky saying stuff like that, because that really does not look good from the, you know, if I'm a recruit or a player and I read that article and I'm like, well, damn, that he just basically said, yeah, he knew what he was doing, and the past several weeks, he's sitting there meeting with me, looking me in my face, telling me, you know, give me a game plan. But in the back of his head, he's like just counting the days down till he's back in Seattle. But luckily that wasn't the case, it seems.
Yeah, it seemed like that wasn't the case. And, you know, that hurts the journalist's credibility 100% now that, you know, Grubbs come out and said, yeah, no, that wasn't really exactly what happened. But I was interested to see, because I believe a couple days, literally like a day or two before that, another story had come out about Austin Mack, and he had really highlighted Ryan Grubb and his ability. So I thought it was kind of interesting that kind of happened in back-to-back days.
Yeah. And then I also saw, I think Austin Mack put something out just saying, like, you know, he's happy for Grubb, but, you know, we're going to keep rolling.
I don't give a piss about nothing but the tie.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. So he seems to be locked in. And that lines up. You know, I think everybody kind of had an idea that Coach Grubb was highly sought after, not just by the Seahawks. It seems like he had several options, whether it was, you know, other coaching jobs in college or whatnot. But again, I think it makes sense how everything's kind of gone down. But it's good to hear from him and hear his thoughts regarding the situation. I did briefly pull up that national championship game, and just from the first series or two, got some okay things about I forgot the guy's name, the Michigan safety that's in the portal.
Keon Sab,
yeah. Well, the first play I see of him on there, he missed the tackle. So he was the guy that in that first play, they dump it to the flats. Number three comes up, he misses that tackle, and they get the first down, which, again, everybody has plays. But then I notice another play, he's kind of –
missed a tackle, we don't want.
Oh, God, here we go. See, he's back. I should have known he would
– rocking and rolling, and then we don't want him.
That's right.
Y'all are so big. You're on wide. I'm listening, right? I'm getting my office set up.
I was giving you a chance to go do what you had to do. But no, I'll say, though, then it's not just that missed tackle, but then a few plays later – they basically ran the ball up the middle. He's playing like a free safety, and he was real hesitant on coming up and run support. And then he kind of like last minute kind of just like throws himself in there after two other people start corralling the guy. What I'm getting at is he doesn't really look like a physical tackler, which, you know, a lot of DBs aren't nowadays. But at the safety spot, he's definitely going to be more of a free safety if he's not going to want to get physical like that. However, he seems to be able to, you know, break up passes and to be a little bit better in the coverage side of things. So that's kind of what I gather. Just, and they get very limited. I literally just looked at that for like 2 minutes, but I was like, dang, well, not quite a tackler. But you know who I think could step up and who could be more of that physical safety that we're not really talking about is Tony Mitchell. I don't know if you are too familiar with him. I mean, you probably are about the off-field incident. I hate to bring that up, but I mean, that unfortunately, that's kind of how he got started here. He was the young man that signed here, then he was at like spring break, and then unfortunately got in trouble getting pulled over, the high-speed thing. Do you know what I'm talking about? Remember that story?
I remember the story.
So he kind of got started on a tough note here, but he did what he had to do. He was disciplined, and
he's back.
They let him back on the team, but quietly behind the scenes, he had been really developing nicely, like in practices and whatnot. He had been playing some good football. And I believe that he could be a guy, again, you know, we've got openings in the secondary. You know, not as many people are talking about him because, again, he was kind of the doghouse last season, kind of working behind the scenes. But he's a guy who, coming out of high school, I mean, he was regarded as a five-star on some services. He's a physical player. He's a bigger guy. He's 6'2", 205, I believe, at least he was, on one of these things he's listed at. So I think he really could end up stepping up. I mean, he's a very versatile player as well, and I think that's somebody that we're not really talking about but could end up stepping up. Plus, I mean, it seems like this might be a little fresh start for him, you know. Not saying that he wouldn't have had that with Coach Saban. You know, he worked his way, you know. But I'm just saying, you know, you got a fresh coach, a new coach, new system, new scheme. It kind of seems like maybe this could be a situation brewing that could be helpful from somebody like him.
So – I want to go back because I didn't get a chance when, you know, Ryan Grubb was speaking. You said to tease at the break that you felt like the whole Seattle Times article about, you know, the time frame, Ryan Grubb, the 30-day window, when that announcement came on that 30th day that we was headed to Seattle. We never really talked about this whole stuff. And was this a conspiracy? You know, I mentioned it when he left. I did mention that because I alluded to that. Well, I kind of mentioned that article.
You want me to read it real quick just to remind?
Yeah, let's go back just kind of remind people what was said, because I don't think a lot of people remember.
So the Seattle Times had put out an article like right after Ryan Grubb was announced to take the job with the Seahawks. And basically the gist of it, I'm just going to read it. Though the Seahawks had interest in Grubb from the start, one reason for waiting to make the hire official was to allow a 30-day window for Alabama players to enter the transfer portal to pass. Nick Saban announced he was retiring as Alabama's coach, opening a 30-day window, but the window passed on Saturday. Again, remember, Ryan Grubb, I think, was announced, or their reports came out, was it Friday night or Friday afternoon, whenever it was. There have also been rumors that Scott Huff, who was UW's offensive line coach in 2022 and 23, followed to board Alabama, could now follow Grubb to Seattle. So they were right about that part, that last part. But the first half, that was a little kind of eye-opening, basically accusing Ryan Grubb in Seattle that of waiting to announce this hire until the portal closed. Because the timing did, like I said, I mean, the portal closed Saturday, and this was kind of, the announcement started coming Friday night, I believe, is when I sent the article to you. So
right.
What were your thoughts on that? Are you still not buying it after the press conference?
I don't think, here's what I know about NFL. They're not going to
care
make
about
this
the
type
window.
Of thing like from a time. No, that's not going to happen.
Right.
Now, could it have been just from DeBoer and Grubb situation to where he said, man, hey, you know, I know that there's interest there. We know. Remember, Greg Burns said they knew all along for a while, weeks, perhaps that there were opportunities for Ryan Grubb to take said job, whether it be Seattle or somewhere else. I think he wanted the Washington job. He just didn't get it. But I think that could have been something. I think, as you know, wink, wink, friend, handshake, friend. Hey, you know, if you're gonna take this job, then that's kind of, you know, I know coaches that's not like this stuff doesn't happen. I mean, I think when people say, "Nah, this is not," I don't think the NFL has anything to do with it. I think it was, if anything, it would have been said, like, just my opinion here, guys, that hey, if you feel like you and your wife want to take this job and it's offered to you, you know, then this time frame is important, because they had the mass exodus and people got mad at me for saying exodus, which it was. And then you want to say, hey, how can we preserve more players? I mean, that's part of it. I mean, I'm not crazy enough not to think that you just, you know, Ryan Williams just signed. And now the coordinator's gone. Yeah, and people, it's easy. And it, to me, it's lazy, absolutely lazy, when someone says, well, it's somebody's offense or somebody's defense. That's part of the truth, right? Ryan Grubb is a guy that he calls his plays. He is the guy. He is the guy that generates the offense. Now, does he go and refer to the coach, situations during the game, things like that? Absolutely. But Ryan Grubb is the guy, so don't, like, think that by him not being at Alabama that this is not a problem. It is. Nick Saban, yeah, it was his defense, and he had many coaches, and we've seen some coaches did better than others, but yet it was Nick Saban's defense. Because you still delegate that authority to the coordinator most of the time. So Ryan Grubb, which everybody said that I heard nationally, locally, how good and how awesome this man was as a coordinator. But then when he decided to leave, it's like some of them same people would say, don't really matter. Don't really matter, because this is, you know, Kalen DeBoer's offense, excuse me. No. It does matter. This is a huge loss. And, of course, yeah, more importantly, the offensive line probably even greater. So my point is, I don't think it was to the magnitude of what the Seattle Times was saying, like there was some kind of crazy NFL and Grubb and Alabama conspiracy on the 30-day. I'm not buying that. But I'm not crazy enough to say, well, could Grubb and Kalen DeBoer might have said, hey, can you wait and known about this job 2 weeks ago? I can believe that based on what Greg Burns said, that they knew that this potentially was going to happen. So I'm not opposed to think that maybe, you know, but at the same time, I don't blame him. I would have been like that too. hey, bro, if you're going to boat, if you're going Audi 5000, can you know, is the situation to get time? Just, I would have done that to preserve some of my players and my roster and my team. Absolutely. And it's not just Alabama. Teams would do that. Coaches would do that. Here's the other thing. I don't trust any coach. I don't think any of us should. Mm. They'll sit there and tell you they're not going somewhere and then be gone the next day. Coaches lie. Now, all of a sudden, we believe coaches when they say certain things, or they get and say something in the press conference that I'm supposed to believe you, bro. Nah, it ain't going that way. Because coaches tell lies, right? That's just what they do. They tell you what you want to hear.
I mean, to be
they
fair,
don't
Coach
care.
Saban literally said he said I couldn't lie anymore. He didn't say
right.
that.
Yeah, I mean,
that's kind of you know what I mean, because he was like, well, technically, because he told, I forgot who it was, they're saying like he told somebody, yeah, I'll, you know, I plan to be here, you know, next 3-4 years. Then technically, he ended up not because he retired. So that's what he was saying. Like, yeah, I couldn't keep.
He had a lot. He had a lot of families. He had a lot of kids. He know what him and Miss Terry was talking about. You got to tell lies. You ain't going to sit there and tell a 5-star Ryan Williams, well, we're talking about it. Right. Hey, I want you to come play for my team. Are you going to, you know, the rumor is other coaches use this against you, right? We already always heard that. Well, you know, we're talking about it. There's about a 70% chance I'm not coming back. He say that nobody's coming to Alabama.
I would use for the word for him. I'd probably say he just probably wasn't as transparent. Just because
wasn't it, honest.
No, because I'll say, well, when he recruited me, I mean, he's very transparent. He tells the truth.
But, no, he keep it real.
Yeah,
but,
he keeps it real. But
it's still lying.
But with,
I mean,
no,
how
but with that
it?
Part, yeah, he probably when he's saying like, yeah, I plan on being there. Technically, that's probably he probably did plan on it, but realistically, he knew it kept kind of creeping in, getting closer and closer to that time. But
I'm
right,
just
no,
not going
to
believe
right,
in
no.
a coach.
No, you're mm-hmm. right. Coaches do. They say one thing, and then things change. I mean, Lou, you got Sean Elliott, man.
They don't even change. They know
Elliott,
these things are going to happen. Well, okay. I'm going to talk about that in the next segment.
No,
because
why would he leave at this time? That's crazy.
See what he did to the
back.
Kids?
That's messed
I love
up,
Sean. That's my boy. We used to have a couple pops together back in the day.
Yeah, well, he screwed that program over. In the middle
yeah,
of spring
the whole
practice.
Program had to shut down for the spring. That's what I'm telling you.
That's
when
crazy.
When we see and attack these kids for transferring, just take a step back and look at the line coaches and look at what they do. Do they care? Do they care about these kids' futures? Do they really? A lot of them don't. That's what I'm saying. We sit here and judge the kids all the time. And Isaiah Bond and listen, you can't be mad at them. This is what I was saying the whole time. You can't be mad at them because at the end of the day, the coaches for always, and they've been doing this. They do what they want to do, and there's no remorse, right? Sean Elliott just left. He came to my program, the University of South Carolina. Great hire for us. Great job by Shane Beamer bringing him in. But boy, he hurt a lot of young men. Let's talk more about this. I know we got to hit a break. 205-342-9904. I hope some folks get in on this because I just love to hear what the fans think about this because this is the truth. Do you believe Kalen DeBoer because or Ryan Grubb who said that they, you know, they want to up and up? Do you believe him? Maybe he's telling the truth. But I'm telling you, man, I have a hard time believing what coaches say because I've been behind the scene. I'm with them. I understand. I know the truth when they come out. I hear the real, as they say. I don't know. But I don't believe the Seattle thing either that the NFL was involved in all this conspiracy of 30-day window. Nah, that ain't happening. Quick timeout. More The Edge here on a free-for-all Friday. I just got my recliners in the office, guys. I'm going to do the second half of the show with my computer and lay back in the recliner. That's going to be awesome. We'll be back.
Weekday mornings at 6 a.m. The Martin Houston Show.
Join us for a Monday edition of The Martin Houston Show powered by Mac Sports. We'll add Kennington Smith III of The Athletic to the conversation. We'll do a round the capstone segment as we look at Bama baseball, Bama basketball, as well as, of course, we'll keep our eyes on what's happening on the football field. We'll have a Manic Monday, and we want you to be a part of it. 205-342-9904. That's the
$5 a line per month for 4 lines. Find us at straighttalk.com. For network management practices, visit straighttalk.com. Device offer ends 4/14/24. Online only. Family plan discount with 4 lines, all on the Silver Unlimited plan. Taxes and fees apply.
Serving part-time in the Army National Guard has led to a lot of firsts for me. It paid for me to be the first person in my family to go to school. That education got me to the first day at my dream job. which I can still hold while I serve part-time. That job and the home loan benefits I got from the Army National Guard helped me buy my first house. I also know that I will be one of the first to respond if my community ever needs me.
Sponsored by the Alabama Army National Guard. Aired by the Alabama Broadcasters Association and this station.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
A very mild afternoon, a mix of sun and clouds, the high 69. Becoming cloudy tonight, the chance of a few scattered rain showers. Colder after midnight, the low 36. Tomorrow, cold and breezy, the sky mostly cloudy, the high 47. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 67 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Peace up, A-Town Daddy.
Ursha, baby, welcome back to the program. Just call me Ursha. How good is that? That's real good. Just call me Ursha, baby.
How good is that food you're chewing?
I'm not chewing in.
And you want to get to the phone lines?
I have zero food in here with me.
There's no
I'm in the office. For sure.
I'm not buying it. I'm not. You got to have a snack. You got to have it. There's got to be
I don't have any freaking thing in here. But you know what's next?
It's got to be gum.
No. No. You know what I was doing? I just licked my tooth.
What? No way.
Yeah, I don't have any food. I don't have any water.
There's no way you're lying. There's no way you're lying.
I can give you the video tour, babe. I mean, it's all the shambles.
I need to see this new office.
I'll give you. I'll do a little video and text it to you.
Let's
I can share the whole thing because it is the Hootie and the Blowfish office. My office is in their office, so you're gonna see a lot of the records.
What is it? But what does that mean, though? That's why you confused.
It's the office of like Hootie and the Blowfish has an office here in Columbia, which where they were originated. It's been here the whole time, and so their main people that run the tours are Darius Rucker and Hootie and the Blowfish. Run Money After the Masters, the golf event, which is a huge celebrity pro-am, which has been going on for almost 30 years. Tiger Woods, Arnold Palmer, the big greats have all played in this tournament that I've been privileged to be a part of. They operate out of our building here, and they had a nice office opened up, and I've been talking about the office and doing the podcast and the radio show and my ministry stuff. Well, I meet with my athletes could come here now. I got my own office and things I can meet with them with NIL stuff. So it's right downtown. I got restaurants. I can just walk right the door and go to a nice Mediterranean restaurant, hamburger, whatever you want. I don't eat all that, but I'm right down what we call Divine Street. And it's right down up from Five Points, which is kind of like the strip in Tuscaloosa. But we're further up where all the businesses are, which is a nicer part. So place called Shandon, which is one of the high-class neighborhood areas in Columbia, South Carolina. So that's where my office is. But in here, I'll do a little video and show you that we got some, you know, album covers and some Grammys, things up on the wall.
Nice.
And then I'm putting all my football jerseys. I got your picture already up on the wall where you just sacked the Clemson quarterback in that one year in New Orleans.
Kelly Bryant.
Gave me a picture of that. Kelly Bryant, yeah. I got that in here, and then the pictures and stuff I'm put up. So it's going to be cool. Got a nice big window. I'm going to have my radio system set up right here. My mic, built-in mic, everything's coming. So it's going to be nice. It's just kind of in here right now, but I got control of this whole
lobby outside. So it sounds like I got to let up on sometimes that I'm critical of the Gamecocks. So I don't want you to get kicked out of your office. So I'll be a little bit nicer.
We can handle the truth. That's the thing. Y'all get your panties in the wad by saying there's an exit. Then you tell me I'm not an Alabama fan all of a sudden.
We accept the truth down here.
If it's bad, if it smells like poop, it's a daggum poop. That's just the way it is. Y'all need to get to that point.
I will say this. I have noticed there's a small majority of a little minority that we do have some fans that are a little overly sensitive. That if it's not what people want to hear, they go in upwards. So you're not wrong, but every fan base has that.
But I want to get back to that more of the coaches stuff and Sean Elliott, because I'm sick of coaches lying and what they're doing to these athletes. I don't like that. I don't like that they had to cancel
or
postpone the spring game and the spring practice because the head coach is all of a sudden out of $5,000 to go be a tight ends coach. Are you kidding me? What is wrong with college football?
That's your guy, man. Get him on the show.
I want to take some phone calls, too. Let's get some stuff going. All right, quick timeout. Come back. We'll be live from Tuscaloosa, the very nice studios. My stuff is not like Skyland Boulevard, right? You ain't got the refrigerator and a big old dog downstairs protecting me. You know, I ain't got all that.
I'm pulling them off.
24/7 U.S.-based customer service. It pays to Discover. Limitations apply. Learn more at discover.com/credit card.
The Alabama Securities Commission protects you from financial fraud. Anyone asking you for investment money must be licensed. You're careful with your money. Fraudsters aren't. Before you invest, call our hotline at 1-800-222-1253 to verify the licensing of the person making an offer and the product. Don't lose your hard-earned money. Learn to protect yourself at asc.alabama.gov. Paid for by the Investor Protection Trust and brought to you by the Alabama Broadcasters Association and this station.
Coming up on The Game with Ryan Fowler.
Coming up on the Friday edition of The Game, presented by Brian Harden Construction. Free for all Friday. We're going to take your phone calls. Brent Beard's going to be a part of our program. We will feature the athletic director at the University of Alabama, Greg Burns, starting at 2 p.m. right here on The Game on Tide 100.9, 1230 WTBC, your home of Alabama Crimson Tide Sports.
The longest running sports program in Tuscaloosa. The Game with Ryan Fowler. Weekdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
WTBC Tuscaloosa and W265 CG Tuscaloosa, a Town Square Media station. Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
From the Fox Sports Studios in Los Angeles, here's Nick Cope.
Two juveniles have been charged in the shooting at the Chiefs Super Bowl rally on Wednesday. A release from Jackson County Family Court said the two minors face gun-related and resisting arrest charges, with additional charges expected to come as Kansas City police continue their investigation. Kansas City Star reports a hearing may be held to determine whether the juveniles can be tried as adults for charges including first-degree assault and murder. Taylor Swift donated $100,000 to the family of Lisa Lopez Galvin, the woman killed in the shooting. Raiders quarterback Jimmy Garoppolo is being suspended 2 games for violating the league's performance-enhancing substances policy. Violation is related to using a prescription medication without having a therapeutic use exemption. Reports say that Vegas is expected to release Garoppolo in mid-March before he's due a roster bonus of more than $11 million.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
And welcome back. We're here on a Friday free-for-all. Hour number two on the way. Corey Miller, Christian Miller, and my man Wyatt on the mics on the 411 or whatever, on the wheels of steel. I think that's what they should call it, on the wheels of steel. Breaking it down. Like, Wyatt, what was that tune? That was pretty cool. I never heard that.
That was California by Childish Gambino. I just picked a random song, and that's what it was.
That was pretty neat. I mean, it's kind of all the different sounds and the different, you know, instruments that went into that. That was pretty cool.
Yeah, that was
good. I love myself some music, man. We should start doing something cool, like on a Music Friday, name that tune.
Okay. As long as it doesn't turn into you doing karaoke, I'm good, man.
Oh, God. I sent you the video.
Yeah, I was watching it. That's cool.
Pretty cool, right?
Yeah, that's not bad at all. That's a nice little office.
I'll tell you, man. Your old man tried to tell you and give you all this good information and tell you the truth. You don't be, he probably thought I was in some kind of shed or something outside.
No, I didn't say that. I just said I wanted to see the office. I mean, I hadn't heard anything about it until literally 30 minutes before the show started. So I just was curious. Let's head.
I got stuff. coming. I got to get it all put up and pictures on it. It just kind of thrown around, but it's going to be nice.
No, it looks good. Let's head to the phone lines. I feel bad. Tommy's been on here. We got KJ on here, too, and probably some more lineups. So let's get Tommy on here real
I'm
quick.
I'm tired of talking.
Start things off. Tommy, welcome into the Miller's Edge. How are you today, sir?
I'm doing great. Wait a minute, Troy. You just told a lie. You're tired of talking. Come on, boy. Come on.
I'm tired.
That's
I'm tired of talking.
You know he loves to talk, Tom. He don't get tired of talking.
All right, Tom, I'm not saying a word. Go ahead. I'm shutting up. Shutting up.
All right, let me call my bookie. I got 5 minutes. You can't. $5.
No, you can't get no 5 minutes straight talk, Tom. You can't talk 5 minutes.
No, I'm going to bet $5. You can't be quiet. I mean, you got to bet. See? You didn't do it. I just could have won my $5. God, you cost me money.
Dang. I'm going to be quiet for 2.5 minutes and let you go. You go right now.
Let me call the, that's my brother. Call the buggy. He said he's going to be quiet for 2.5 minutes. But no, little coach's thing out in Seattle, I think his little, you know, the old saying, happy wife is a happy life.
Mm.
So I think that had a lot to do with it, too. So, I mean.
Maybe.
So he just don't like Alabama. I said, well, you know, I hear that from other fan bases. But I'm like, well, he turned Georgia down last year, and he turned A&M down. So, you know, Ron grew up. So, you know.
He turned all those schools down?
What?
He turned all those schools down?
Yes.
Dang.
Yeah, but what I would have been told that he interviewed at Georgia after Alabama. He didn't take neither one of the jobs. And somebody said, Jimbo was going to pay him some money to come to A&M, and he read the writing on the wall. Why do you think they got Bobby Petrino? I mean, no, I didn't want to go to A&M to be the offensive coordinator because that was a sinking ship fast. I mean, so that proved to be right.
Dang.
But you blew my thing. I had a great thing for y'all. See, y'all were talking about young player and some former player playing in the USFL. I think y'all two need to make a comeback. I'll be your manager. Y'all try out for the Stallions.
I might have a better chance of that than him right now, if we're being honest.
When y'all argue after the game, we'll put a ring up and we'll have a wrestle match. So I'll sell tickets. I'll be your manager. No, you missed that call, Chrissy. You missed that tackle, Dad. Just slow it out. Get the lead out. Oh, it'd be great. We sell them.
All right, my 2.5 minutes are up. So give me my $5. You can Venmo or Cash App.
No,
Zelle.
Matter of fact, you was only 2 minutes because I had the time on the.
Oh, I ain't trusting your watch. I ain't trusting your watch.
It's my how I make Mississippi mud cake. It never fails, so don't doubt my time on my stove.
Okay. Now let me respond to something you said about a happy wife and a happy life.
Yeah.
Right. So what you're trying to say, Mama? Because he's married to the sister, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So sounds like the sister don't like the South.
Maybe she has. Maybe she heard some kind of.
I mean, man, let's just be honest with you. I did hear this. I didn't want to bring it up when all this. I did hear that the whole South and the interracial marriage situation, which we know Sarkisian's interracially married, right?
He's at Alabama. You know how many men do? I'm pretty sure.
So why would they? Why, but some people still have that mystique.
Jamarcus Shepherd's wife is white. That's interracial. Who else is on the new staff?
The people did say, but that's what
maybe if
the woman didn't want to come
here,
to the
maybe
South.
If she's not from down here, she might have heard, you know, just, you know, stereotypes, whatever it is. But if I'm being honest with you, I don't think that's the whole deal. They might just like Seattle. You know what I mean? Maybe they just.
Well, Seattle is kind of different for all that kind of stuff.
Seattle is a complete 180 from anything.
Yeah.
But that's what I'm saying. Might not have nothing to do house. About the. I mean, I did hear that crap. If that's the case, that's just unfortunate. Because, I mean, that's just, honestly, if some people just like the Pacific Northwest. Some people like living up north. Some people like living down south. I mean, honestly, might be that. Some people just don't like moving.
Alabama is great.
Some people
Alabama,
just don't want
to
move.
I tell people, I mean, but the mystique is there about Alabama. About Mississippi. When I go play the golf tournament, my friends play. It's something that people, I'm in South Carolina, I'm sitting there going like, this are the most backwards peoples here that I've ever seen. Like, why do y'all think Alabama is such a weird place if you minority. I mean, and I tell them all the time how nice Tuscaloosa is, because they'll say, well, why Christians want to live down there? I mean, but I'm just saying, when you think about, do people really throw that out there?
Ass man can do what I want to do.
Right, but do people really, really believe that, Tommy? That's what I'm saying. And
I'll make a point. Well, you say you didn't want to get in politics. Poor old Coach Bryant. No, Coach Bryant had a hell of a time in the 60s when one of our governors, George Wallace, was a pain in his backside. And I'm being kind when I say backside.
Okay.
I mean, it cost Bryant national championship, Wallace. And when he lost the 66th national championship, they was defending back-to-back national championship, 64-65. Alabama went undefeated. Notre Dame and Mixon State tied in the great game, I think 10-10 or whatever. And we were denied the national championship. They played politics, split, and gave it to Notre Dame. All right. Coach Bryant, right then, I'm going to say this, don't get on to me. He told George Wallace to go to hell. All right? Mm. Because he said, I'm going to recruit black players. We are going to get in the 20th century. So there's too many great football players that happen to be black is leaving this state. And a bunch of them went to Southern Cal. In 1970, we played Southern Cal in Leederville. And we got our hiney spanked by John McKay, Sam Bam, and Cunningham. And then Bryant made a point. And he got to say, that's why you see Wilbur Jackson and John Mitchell outside the football stadium. They was ground setter, just not only on the football field, for the state of Alabama, as human beings, as good Alabamians. So, you know, we have to live with that stigmatization, because Wallace had burned it into people's minds that we are a bunch of nothing but redneck, barefoot, carrying shotgun, and spit tobacco off the front porch. And got a rebel flag in the back of the pickup.
Red man, that tobacco red man.
Mm-hmm. Red man, chew up. I guess Coach, I don't want to spill the beans, you know, but a very prominent coach around here loves his red man anyway.
I'm just sick of all that stuff. I mean, it's like, but people were saying, I don't know if that was, but like Christian heard that too. I mean, it's like she didn't want to come to Alabama. That was
about his wife.
Yeah.
I mean, but to me, that's just uneducated people that just are just hearing stupid stereotypes. Just like you said, I mean, like whether it's Alabama, Mississippi, or whatever, like without you being, you know, like from the South or, you know, having any ties like deep South, stuff like that. I mean, people just go off of old things. But that might not even be the case. Again, I'll be honest. Even if you're from, you know, the South or somewhere, you know, similar, some people just – Tuscaloosa is, you know, a smaller town. If you're coming from a place like Seattle, it's going to be a culture shock, right? I mean, just like kids come here from all over the place, you know, it's a culture shock for a lot of people just because it's a lot different. Like, a lot of people that are used to going to these big malls and things like that. I mean, yeah, you can go to Birmingham, but in Tuscaloosa, there's not no big mall like that. You know what I mean? Like, there's not a lot of stuff, you know, so – some people just aren't as interested in that. So, I mean, that's fine. But that's if that's the deal. All I know is dude took the Seattle job. It's a great, great move for him and his career. Good for him. But, I mean, I'll be honest, by the end of this weekend, I'll forget that he ever was even hired here.
He won't be a name that have any kind of stability to Alabama. I mean, it's going to be just moving. And it's going to move on. And whoever, you know, Nick Sheridan will be the guy. Yeah, I mean, I think we all will be focused on what he can get done as the OC of the Alabama Crimson Tide. Tommy, real quick before we let you go, what you got planned for the weekend? You going to the softball, baseball, and basketball?
Yes. Yeah, I'm probably not going to make it on Ron Fowler's show today because my brother's already patting his foot. I said, man, they don't play at 4 o'clock. It's only 1:15. Hold your horses. But we're ready for softball.
You're a big softball guy, so I need you to be our
softball analyst.
Correspondent on the ground for us
I'll give you a report Monday.
Are you going to both games today, Tommy? Are you going?
I'm going to both. I'm going to every game this weekend.
Oh, dang. I might try to check it. Yeah, I'm going to check out one of them. I might go either tomorrow, though. I'm trying to decide. I don't know. There's so many different things to do this weekend, but
you got to get one of each. Make sure you get to the Joe, because the Joe, I love the coach. I can't wait to get him on. I love his energy. I love what he did at Maryland, and And
You're talking about baseball. I'm sorry, Rob Vaughn.
Yeah, baseball. I'm talking about how he believes in the fun and making the game day experience like a party. I heard him talk about that. I'm looking forward to catching a game down there this spring myself. Cause I love being out there with baseball and, you know, get me some salt-free popcorn and a Diet Coke, man, and be out there with my cut-off jean shorts and cowboy boots ready to go.
That's a little much, man.
Tom, you know what I mean? I'm going to get some cut-off shorts, jean shorts, some Wranglers, and some cowboy boots, and a piece of your mud pie with some salt-free popcorn. Let's get to the joke. Let's go.
Okay, yeah, let's go. I got one question.
Okay.
How scarred up your legs?
My knees fell up. I got a lot of carpet burns for the wrong reason.
Well,
huh?
I did. Oh, Lord. Somebody need to go to church Sunday. I'm
going to
tell you that now.
I don't know what the hell you just said.
I'm just kidding, man. This, we all grown. We can joke. It's a joke.
I don't know if you even realize kind of what you did. Whoa.
I was going to say something profound, but I just forgot what I was going to say.
It's all right, Tommy. I'm borderline speechless after what I just heard.
Yeah.
All right, Tommy. I'm sorry to mess your point up, buddy. I'm just having fun. That's all.
I know. It's Friday. It's a free-for-all Friday.
It's free-for-all Friday. What is it for? We supposed to laugh.
He's on his knee. What are you saying?
For the wrong reason. You took him for that. He said, how scarred are my legs? I said, my knees are burned, but they're for the wrong reason. I got burned up knees for the wrong reason.
As a man, you should not. Never mind. The only time you should be on your knees is praying, brother.
The only time I ever had any kind of injury, I slipped off my back porch 4 years ago. And I did a wonderful cartwheel. The gymnastics coach, we've been happy with my stand, but my knee gave away. Guess what? I tore that sucker slapped off.
Mm.
And the pandemic here, they wouldn't do surgery. Let me tell you, my knee, every time the weather changed, I did when I was 59 years old, I'll be 63 next month. Let me tell you something. When the weather changed,
you hurt.
I hurt. Bing Gay is my new best friend, or heating pad or whatever. My knee hurt.
I feel you. I can feel you with arthritic fingers, toes, and neck. I can feel you, brother. Tommy, enjoy the softball game, man. And I know y'all, it'll be beautiful weather, beautiful time. And hopefully the Tide gets a big doubleheader win today. That'd be awesome.
It will be. I'll see you sometime this weekend, Kristen.
Yes, sir. That sounds good, Tommy.
There you go. See, I gave Tommy so much time today because it's Friday. KJ still on hold. Can we get KJ?
No, bro, we got to go to his break. It's 1:15. Okay. You know, don't do KJ like that. I'm on 30 seconds, man. Give KJ a whole second. We good.
That's all he needs.
We'll take a quick timeout, then they'll open up with KJ. Let him have plenty of time. You're listening to the Miller's Edge right here on Tide 100.9, 1230 a.m. WTBC, we are the home of Alabama Crimson Tide Sports, presented by the Good Feet Store, America.
A line per month for 4 lines. Find us at straighttalk.com. For network management practices, visit straighttalk.com. Device offer ends 4/14/24. Online only. Family plan discount with 4 lines, all on the Silver Unlimited plan. Taxes and fees apply.
My caretaker was very rough with me. I thought they did it because I wasn't moving fast enough.
Elder abuse is a crime, and together we can stop it. If you or someone you know has been abused, neglected, or exploited, call the Adult Abuse Hotline at 1-800-458-7214. That's 1-800-458-7214. Sponsored by the Alabama Department of Human Resources, the Department of Justice, ADECA Grant Number 18-VA-VS-050, the ABA, and this station.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
A very mild afternoon, a mix of sun and clouds, the high 69. Becoming cloudy tonight, the chance of a few scattered rain showers. Colder after midnight, the low 36. Tomorrow, cold and breezy, the sky mostly cloudy, the high 47. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 67 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Yeah, nice sounds right there, my man Wyatt putting it down. putting it down. Welcome back to the Mills Edge on Tide. 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC, 205-342-9904. Don't forget about my good friends at R&R Cigars. That's rnrcigars.com. I know if you're not in Tuscaloosa, we have listeners all over from Tennessee, Alabama, Florida, California. We've heard calls from all over, right here, even in South Carolina. If you want to check out that website, get those cigars shipped to you for absolutely free, just use that code, the Miller's Edge. They'll take care of you. If you're in town in Tuscaloosa, what a great day. All these games going on. You're going to take a break. You want to get you a nice smoke. Great humidor, the best there is in all the Southeast. A great bar, great bourbons, all kinds of drinks for you. Drink responsibly. They got that for you. Or if you're just there for the afternoon, the night, hang out. You want some privacy, get your own room, you and your friends, your business meeting, all of that good stuff. They got great private rooms for you. All has recliners in them. Lay back, put your feet up, take your shoes off, smoke your cig, and get you a nice adult beverage right there at R&R Cigars. Randy and Reagan, good people, will take great good care of you. All right, KJ. My man KJ is in the ATL. I love to get some info about the three-piece on Valentine's Day, see how that went. KJ, what's up, buddy?
What's going on, man? It was like,
what's
know,
that?
It was like the wisest king in the Bible. You know, King Solomon was the wisest king. You know why he was wise.
Nah, you tell me why he was wise.
And he kept them together. Guys, he was the wisest king ever.
They have a good time. I mean, did you go eat with one or three?
I ate with one, but yeah, it was a good Valentine's Day. Let's just say that. It wasn't better than yours. I heard you trying to be on your knees and stuff. What, you trying to get a sponsor for Vaseline?
I got a sponsor for some Vaseline. You know, a lot of people don't know about that Vaseline. When you got them old dark, cut up, crusty knees.
Of course.
When your knees get scraped up,
you put the Vaseline on your knees and your elbows. I mean, when you're crusty or you got crazy dry skin, Vaseline. You know about the Vaseline.
So it's our mind, Christian.
Yeah. I don't know what y'all talking about.
Brother, all I know is I'm not even going to get back into it. That's what I'm saying. I think we might have been on different pages, but you got out there on that last one, though. But it's all good. We're going to let it slide because obviously it was a misunderstanding. I think old head just kind of had a different turn.
Yeah, y'all did that. I know what y'all was talking about, but that's not what I was talking about.
Homie, the way you said it.
You got something, Corey. You was definitely talking about that. You're not fooling nobody.
KJ, I don't know what you're talking about, you know? I'm saying, like, okay. What you talking about?
This is my question to you. So we got to cut the laughing because I got to come at you now with
okay.
this.
Okay.
Who in the world left because of Ryan Grubb? Like, what person you think left because of Ryan Grubb?
Left the program?
Was in danger of leaving because of Ryan Grubb?
I don't know. I don't think any. I would say that no one left because. I mean, he didn't leave to the 30th after the deadline. Remember?
I don't buy that one.
I don't buy the NFL, all of that. I don't buy that. But don't tell me coaches don't get in the cahoots with one another and be like, hey, we know this has happened. Because I go back and I remember what Greg Byrne said. Remember what he said? That they kind of had an idea a couple of weeks ago that this probably was going to happen. Or something was going to happen.
I took that as people were looking at him, that he was getting an attractive job.
That's what he kind of said, but don't think he didn't know. That's all I'm saying. Don't think they didn't know what was happening. I mean, then there was all this stuff about, is he going to make an announcement? Then all of a sudden, at that red elephant sign and celebration, all of a sudden, you know, you get up there like the president and be like, hey, my name is Ryan Grubb, and I'm your offensive coordinator of the Alabama Crimson Tide.
He has to.
You know,
that
emphatic statement.
What's different? What's different than Ryan?
Right, but that meant nothing.
No, what's different than what's different than Isaiah Bunn saying, I'm Isaiah Bunn at an NIL function. I'm Isaiah Bunn, the grave digger catcher for Alabama, and then leave and go to Texas. There's no difference.
No. There's a big difference.
There's no difference.
Because he was the grave digger catcher. That's in the record.
And Ryan Grubb was the OC at Alabama at that time.
How many plays did Ryan Grubb call at Alabama?
It doesn't matter. He had the title of the OC at Alabama at the time.
I get that. But the problem is, I don't think his heart was never in it. You know, he did what he had to do. They never really had a contract. They never really had nothing. It was kind of like, you know, we working on a handshake and a smile.
I think he would have left the job if it wasn't for an NFL job. I don't think he was going to leave for the head coaching job.
If it had been Washington, he would have left.
For the head coaching job, yeah. But I don't think he would have stayed at Washington for a little. Yeah. And that's okay.
But listen, I ain't hating on Ryan Graham. Who's mad at him? I mean, you can't be mad at him. But when you hear
things. You got to realize that the only people that are going to be loyal to a university are the fans and the former players that graduated from that university. Everybody else, the coaches, anyone else, they can leave the next day.
Absolutely. That's why I said I don't believe any coach. I don't care what Ryan Grubb said. Wyatt played the clip. I mean, because I know, and I've been in the meetings, I've been in the rooms, I talked to these dudes. I know what these conversations are like.
I think you're digging too deep, though. I think it's pretty much what he said. And I'll be honest with you, like, judging by just how he talks and his body language, I mean, he seems
straight.
Oh,
yeah, that means everything.
I'm not saying it means everything, but I also...
cut and dry. Exactly, Christian. Yeah.
I'm just saying, I know, I mean, like, don't act like I'm not in the complex. I know these people. I'm just saying, like, the dude was here. He took the job here. He moved down here for the past few weeks, and he was doing his job because that was his job. He anticipated being here, but he knew that he was being interviewed and had interest. What I'm saying was, I agree with KJ. If he didn't get a head coaching job that he liked or this NFL opportunity, he was going to be the offensive coordinator here. Why else would he even come down here from the get-go? He could have.
And you got to remember, Seattle interviewed. They tried to interview the
they
the
wanted
Giants.
Chip Kelly.
Oh, see. No, remember they tried to interview the Giants coach, too, and they told him no. They blocked that interview.
Oh, dang.
Absolutely. Yeah, they did. That happened. But here's what I'm saying is I don't have a problem with it regardless. I don't. But I don't like when people say it's no big deal. Like when you just blow it off, like losing Ryan Grubb is no problem because it's Kalen DeBoer's offense. And what I'm trying to say is.
The reason I called was because of Ryan. You brought up Ryan Williams. Ryan Williams has never mentioned Ryan Grubb's name. Like every time you hear that kid talk, he's talking about Shepard or you talking about DeBoer.
But
so I don't even think that would have mattered.
You don't think you don't think it was a selling point to play in that play caller's offense? You don't think Ryan Grubb never? You don't think he's never had a conversation with Ryan Williams about how he potentially could use him in that said offense?
It's even worse if he had a conversation with him and he's not mentioning him when he's been asked about what are you excited about to play for, and he's saying Shepard and DeBoer.
I'm gonna be straight
up. You think he's excited about playing for Nick Sheridan?
Listen, I'm gonna be straight up with you. I think Ryan Williams is gonna come here regardless, as long as they didn't lose him, right? And what I mean by
that
is,
was right. He was coming.
He wanted to play at Alabama.
Okay.
Ryan Williams. No, I'm saying this is what he said. He said in the interview. He said he always has wanted to play at Alabama. He just wanted to beat the new staff, and all they had to do was basically a checklist. He wanted to meet the new staff and be able to check it off and say, yeah, they're a good staff. And I think he was sold on Coach DeBoer, Coach Shepard, and that's good. Now, obviously, Coach Grubb was probably involved in that, but in his eyes, he just looks at it as, oh, well, Coach DeBoer and Coach Shepard here, you know what I'm saying, they'll just find another play caller. Like, I think sometimes we try to dive too deep into things when it's really not necessary. You know what I mean? Like,
it's surface level,
but
yeah.
I do, but to be fair, I get what my dad's saying to the point. He's just saying, when they brought Ryan Grubb here, everybody was ecstatic about it. It was like, oh, they're bringing Ryan Grubb, like this highly sought after
coach. Well, if Coach Saban tried to hire him last year, Coach Saban solidified Ryan Grubb. Let's just be real about this, boys.
Oh,
Coach Saban did that. No. Because you listen to people's conversations, and what came out of their mouth was, you know he must be legit.
But you know what?
Because Coach Saban wanted to hire him. That was okay.
Remember last year, they said that he never got offered the job because remember they said that? It was like,
right.
He never got offered the job anyways.
He got offered the job.
So that's what I'm just saying. But my point is, then you can't have it both ways. Here's my point with people. You can't say, and this is a lot pointed towards media types, right? Oh, how big of a deal that is because Coach Saban wanted this guy. Right? They got the Joe Moore award-winning offensive line coach. And then don't come back when they're not here and undermine it by saying, oh, well, it's Kalen DeBoer's offense. No, ma'am or sir. You can't have it both ways. Right?
Okay. Yeah, and
so y'all hear
that's all I'm saying.
I get what you're saying, but that's why I said on the video I posted, I said, to me, you're not being real with yourself if you just minimize them leaving. Now, however, do I think it's like the coach DeBoer hired is useless now that they left? No, I don't think so at all. But I think if you just say, oh, this is not a loss, like you sum it up as, oh, it's no big deal.
Staff grade definitely went down. Like it went from a solid B plus to now it's a B minus. Like, you got to be honest.
Right.
It definitely went down.
Oh, to what minus?
I'm at a B minus right now at the current state. Depending
you
on
went
what
from
they
B plus only down to a minus?
Yeah. All right, a B. Is that satisfying? Like,
I think you got to go at least a whole a letter.
No.
So you're going to tell me that Nick Sheridan taking the place of one Ryan Grubb.
I don't care about them. I'm talking about the people that he kept. He kept Freddie Roach. He kept. I'm talking about the whole staff.
No. I'm talking about the offense.
I'm not worried. See, the offense, I give the offense right now. I still give it a B because you got Shepard still. Shepard is a really good get, man.
I would say if we're only looking at the offensive side, it's TBD still, though. We don't know who the offensive line coach
is. You
got to
be TBD. You got to go incomplete, KJ. You know I love you, bro. I ain't got nothing but love. There's no way you lose a Joe Moore winning offensive line coach, which everybody raved about.
You said that didn't matter because they played against the Pac-12. So that don't matter.
That's me. But I'm saying for you. But then you lose your play caller, right? Ryan Grubb has been with Kalen DeBoer for most of the stops.
For sure.
But then you get Nick Sheridan. Let's just be real about it. I've been trying to be nice. I ain't going to lie to you. My son be calling me, Dad, you too hard. But,
Oh, hold on. First of all, don't word it like that. Like, hey, you're too hard. I'm like, no, you don't. No, what I say is you sound a little out there. You're going to run people off our damn show because you're trying to, I keep it real.
Definitely,
I keep it real.
I be commenting like, yo, he's mad at the media, y'all, not y'all. Like,
yeah, see, that's what I'm saying. I have to do a PR control with him because I'm like, he doesn't mean it. He's just speaking his mind, but I'm like, it's a delivery, though. I'm like, you have to word it. Or like, if you're going to be critical, like, also point out, like, show the whole picture. Like, say, hey, this is a positive, but then this is something I have to... You just go straight out.
This is the world
Ryan,
we live in today.
This is the whole world we live in,
guys. Let me talk nice to you two young pups.
Man, hold on.
This is the world we live in.
Nah,
right?
I can take it.
Because don't say nothing too bad to little Sammy. Give him a trophy. Just give him a trophy.
It ain't about that.
You know what I mean? Because we want them to feel good about themselves, even though it's not good. But that's the world we live in. I get it. But here's what I'm going to say. Nick Sheridan, to me, you had an offensive coordinator title for 2 years, right? Am I correct?
Yes.
Or a year and a half, or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in your second year of being the offensive coordinator, you got fired at Indiana.
For sure.
So I don't care about you being hired at Washington as a tight end coach, which was the lowest coaching job on the totem pole, right? You get to Alabama, that's what you are again, and we know relationships matter. So now that you have been upgraded to OC based on what we know about Ryan Grubb, I can't say you're going to give him a B plus and now say I'm there a B because we don't know enough about Nick Sheridan.
I'm giving that in return of DeBoer calling the plays, bro. I'm not giving
But you
that
don't know if he's calling the plays. You don't know that.
I would put my money on he's going to be heavily involved in calling plays.
Unless you want to get ran out of town quick.
Now we're talking. So you agree with me, if it's Nick Sheridan, you're going to drop that grade way down. Correct.
It's not just the name. I think he's just saying, like, if he's going to go out, he's going to go out
the
on
name
his
is
own
about
sword,
what
like,
his job has been.
I'm just saying it's Bama. It's kind of different. It's Bama. Like,
right.
You
that's what I'm saying.
With it. No, and that's what I'm saying. I'm sure if he does not know, he's going to get a real quick understanding of who the fans are at Alabama.
God, they going
to
turn
that's
on
not
you
even
real
nothing
fast.
To talk. Like, yeah, I'm not even really worried about that. Like, it's either do or die. It's A or B. It's no in between with Alabama fans.
That's what I like. When I say keep it real, I have real conversations. That's all. I want Bama to be at number one at the end of the year, but what I see at the staff right now, I'm not so sold on it. So what you want me to say? Yeah, guys, we're going to be good. But no, I don't know yet until
I see nobody's
it.
Saying you to sit there and pump sunshine like that. But what I'm saying is, this is how I go about it, right? Am I as impressed?
We got
like,
a break.
We can take a few minutes over. We'll be all right. What I do is I'm like, look, Is this staff as impressive now that they've lost Ryan Grubb and Scott Huff? Absolutely not. I mean, again, if you say they are, then you're lying. That's not true. That or you got glasses on.
You heard that, KJ.
But I will say, though, there's still an opportunity for things still to work out solid, which I think they will. Because, again, just like KJ was saying, I think that just means Coach DeBoer will be more involved in this offense. He can kind of walk Nick Sheridan, or I think Jamarcus Shepard is going to be involved too, right? Walk guys through, and they'll kind of put their heads together. And then we'll see who they hire for the offensive line coach. And plus, they still got to hire a new tight ends coach, unless they make the Jay Nunez guy involved. I don't know.
What ooh, that'll be. Oh, that now fans are gonna go crazy on that.
You don't think they'll be happy about that, KJ?
Not at all. No, they should riot.
Right.
So, but I want to make a quick point.
Go ahead.
A quick point though. With Stav, both of his brothers came down for Junior Day, and they offered him. So it's a little bit of foreshadowing doing there. I'm liking what we're doing, so hopefully we end up landing.
So you're gonna say that we're gonna land them.
I said both of his brothers came down for Junior Day, and we offered him. If we don't land him, we got to talk to that GM because he's from Michigan.
That or you got to talk to Yay Alabama, man, because, I mean, unfortunately, we know how this thing works now. That's really what these guys.
Well, yeah, we got to talk to Courtney Morgan. I'm going to send him a message on Facebook or whatever, Twitter, X.
Yeah.
Become
Bama
on
Rick
show.
Ross, we got to talk to you.
Bama Rick
yeah, let's go, Rick Ross. Let's go. Rick Ross, let's go, baby. Come on the real show over here. We're going to talk for real.
I'll try to get him on the show next week. I'll reach out.
Good luck.
All right, KJ,
be well, man. Don't spend too much money on those pieces this weekend. That's expensive to have three pieces.
Yeah, so you too. Oh, man.
Three pieces. That's too expensive. Man, we're just having fun.
There we are. We got Josh on the line from Georgia, though. It's free for all Friday. Josh
and Georgia going to be totally agreeing with me. I know. I can just feel in the spirit. He's going to be in agreement with me.
You'll have access to leading-edge technology to match your forward-thinking spirit and free shipping on everything. Again, that's Dell.com/deals.
365, 24/7. You'll find road and utility crews, tow trucks, law enforcement, and first responders working along Alabama's roadway.
We're making improvements and helping our communities stay connected.
We're working hard to make sure you're safe on the road. Now we need your help to make sure we're safe too.
Alabama's move over law requires you to move over a lane when you see flashing lights on the roadside. And if you can't safely move over, please slow down.
Visit drivesafealabama.org, brought to you by the Alabama Department of Transportation, Alabama Broadcasters Association, and this station.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
/136 Free Fall Friday, Corey Miller, Wyatt, Christian Miller. Loving the sounds on the Free For All Friday. We're talking coaching. Listen, by the way, Alabama, man, they got to get this staff ready to roll, bro. They're about 2 weeks away from spring ball. I mean, what's going on? I mean, how soon or how long do you expect for them to take, Christian, to get a tight ends coach?
And offensive line coach. I say by mid next week. I think mid next week they'll probably end up making because they're in the middle.
Spring ball is like a little over 2 weeks away.
Yeah, they're in the process of doing fourth quarter right now. I know that the freshmen have been doing the fourth quarter program, and I think today might be the first day that everybody's doing it, something like that. But anyway, so yeah, I mean, and with that comes, you know, they can meet. I believe I think they can go in meeting rooms and start doing the install and all that stuff. So. Yeah, it's going to be important, man. I mean, right now, if you don't have an offensive line coach and tight end coach, I mean, those are days, I guess, somewhat wasted that you're not really getting to work with that position coach now. But if I had to guess, they probably have, like, an analyst or GA or somebody kind of filling in for those meetings or doing some install stuff in the meantime. But you definitely want to fill those roles as quickly as possible. But we'll see, though. I haven't heard any names. Again, you know me, I don't text people. I don't reach out. I don't really do all that, but –
everybody else is doing, just go steal everybody's coaches.
I mean, I feel like you kind of got no choice at this point, right?
It's what it is. Yeah. Offer them the big money and go get them.
Yeah. Well, let's go to Georgia real quick. Let's hear from Josh, see what he has to say with all this. Josh, welcome into the Miller's Edge. How are you today?
Good afternoon. Well, I'm headed down the road and just listening to everything that's going on, trying to stay in touch, recruiting and all that. I'm out of Tuscaloosa, Alabama.
Nice.
Yes, sir.
But I will not lie. I was mad the first part of the week whenever I wake up and I've seen actually I think it's Ryan's Facebook page, Ryan Valley. Ryan Grubb got stolen away overnight by the Colts, and still, y'all been talking about it. I still ain't made time which way to go with it. But it doesn't matter to me, really, who the offensive coordinator is, because it is Jalen DeBoer's system. So.
But let me ask you this, because I agree, you're right. It's Kalen DeBoer's system, so the system's not going anywhere. We know that. We've established that. Just like Coach Saban, you know, as always, it's been his system, his defense.
Right.
But do you don't have any thoughts about, you know, the guy calling the plays, right? Because even with it being Coach Saban's defense, you know, he always gave, whether it was Kirby, Jeremy Pruitt, whoever. You know, they were in charge of calling the plays. Now, obviously, he has, you know, final say. He can veto things. But it's,
and override.
Yeah, but it's always important that you have somebody that you trust, you know, going through the game plan. So if I'm Kalen DeBoer, I personally would probably have my hands involved in the play calling. What do you think?
I don't doubt that. Like you said about having him, Shepard, like the three of them. Jamarcus Shepard was named co-offensive coordinator, and if Sheridan was to go at one year, obviously Shepard declined to step up, but I look for Coach DeBoer obviously to be heavily involved. Am I disappointed about Ryan Grubb? Sure. Am I going to get over it? Yes.
Yeah.
Here's what I was saying real quick, George. I think that it is Kalen DeBoer's offense, and here's what I do know, because I've been in these situations many times with pros and in college, right? When you sit somebody's offense, they're the mastermind, right? They're the one that created this offense, and they know all the ins and outs and all the nuances pertaining to said offense. But it's important when you talk about when you relieve and say, hey, I'm going to allow somebody else to call these plays and, you know, put their little wrinkle on it, that's a whole nother thing, right? My worry, my concern, it would be that if Kalen DeBoer says, hey, it's my offense, you know what? I know I have to have a coordinator by title, but I'm going to be the play caller. I don't have a problem with it. I think you don't lose anything with Ryan Grubb being gone. But if you're saying to me, well, I'm going to delegate this authority to Nick Sheridan, right, and trust him at this point, I'm a little nervous, and I think because he hasn't done enough. He doesn't have the resume to support that he even deserves it.
Sure.
And that's why I'm like, I don't know about that one, because he hadn't shown to be very good as an offensive coordinator, as a play caller. So that would worry me. Now, if Kalen DeBoer says, hey, I'm going to call the plays, I'm good with it, because then what you're saying is his offense makes sense. But when you delegate all that authority to somebody else, a guy especially, that hasn't done it, then I'm a little bit nervous.
Right. Whenever it was mentioned that Coach Grubb had even left, I was looking for Marcus Shepard to obviously be the one promoted, because me and actually another best buddy here in Georgia, we were talking. He was thinking the same thing. Because Jamarcus Shepard, he's been with Coach DeBoer at Washington. I think he's a little bit more experienced.
Yeah.
From what I've seen as far as just reading about both Sheridan and Shepard.
I think it was a huge key to retain Jamarcus Shepard. But you're right, yeah. No, having him on board, so yeah, he has kind of picked up that co-OC titles, and go ahead.
Years, who's to say in 2 years that either one of these guys will be in Tuscaloosa if we have a dynamic year and do what we know Alabama can do if we put together a solid team and Coach DeBoer does a tremendous job his first year. You can look at it from both sides. You can look at it as we nose dive. You can look at it as just in what Alabama football is and what that logo stands for. So, I mean, there's two sides to a coin, right?
Yeah, no, there is.
That's correct.
We'll have to wait and see, and hopefully this new staff.
I'm excited about it. I really Coach Saban was my childhood guy. Coach Saban was my childhood. But I am excited. The energy that I've just felt coming from Tuscaloosa about Coach DeBoer. I mean, I watched the video, the live stream Tide 100.9 provided of the plane landing, the fans cheering that was there that met him. I am excited.
And I think you should be. I mean, you should be excited for whoever the hell comes after Coach Saban, because that's your new football coach, whether people like it or not. But let me ask you this, though, because you sound very optimistic, which is great. But what are your expectations for year one under Coach DeBoer? What would you be okay with, knowing that it's his first year?
Record-wise
for this first season.
Record-wise, I have sat there to walk through the schedule. I would settle for 9-3, but then I really have to ask myself, who is our three losses? Because I don't want to lose to Tennessee. I don't want to lose to LSU. I don't want to lose to Georgia, because those are my three, probably, well, besides Auburn, those are my four SEC schools that I despise the most. you might drop the one to Oklahoma. I mean, I don't want to say that their first year in the SEC, because then they'll get the big head. Oh, we beat Alabama. Where's the stuff?
Yep.
So it's really like, who are we going to drop one to? Because if you look at it, don't we get Missouri, South Carolina, and Vanderbilt again this year?
Yeah,
correct.
We do.
At home.
And Missouri. So really, who are we going to drop one to in the conference? I mean, realistically, it seems like Georgia would be the only one, but I don't want to do that because they're coming into our house. And I say that like I played, but I didn't. Christian, he did play. But they're coming into our house. We don't want to let them.
I think I'd be nervous about Missouri.
There's 100,000 seats in there, Josh.
I think you got to be worried about Missouri, and I think you got to be worried about Wisconsin because of the early game.
Wisconsin's a road game. That's what, third game of the season?
Yeah.
Second or third.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then Missouri, who's playing turnaround football. I mean, I watched the last couple of their games last year just to watch it.
They're looking good. Josh.
Well, we're headed to the road. Like I said, I'm going to go celebrate Valentine's Day a little bit late with the girlfriend. And then in the morning, I am headed to Tuscaloosa and taking my first trip to Coleman Coliseum.
There you go.
Yes, sir. Let's go.
Maybe I'll walk by and run into you in there. I'll probably be at the game, too. It's an early one, but I'll be there. It's at 11.
Yeah, I know. I got to get up at 5 o'clock and drive in, but I'm going to do it.
There you go.
Well, get some rest, man. Drink some good old Starbucks coffee and drive safe, man. Be safe on the road. We definitely appreciate you listening and calling.
Yeah, appreciate it. Y'all have a good day and roll tide.
Yes, sir.
Roll tide. Be well. Back to you. All right, quick break. We'll come back. More calls, any Tide app messages. We'll read those, and we'll finish up this show right here on the Free for All Friday. Yeah. Back in a moment.
Coming up on The Game with Ryan Fowler.
Coming up on the Friday edition of The Game, presented by Brian Harden Construction. Free for All Friday, we're going to take your phone calls. Brent Beard's going to be a part of our program. We will feature the athletic director at the University of Alabama, Greg Burns, starting at 2 p.m. right here on The Game on Tide 100.9, 1230 WTBC, your home of Alabama Crimson Tide Sports.
The longest running sports program in time.
Find a store or switch suavemente at totalbyverizon.com. Monthly rate when you activate without a pay, plus taxes and fees. Discount begins the month after you enroll. Additional terms apply. See website for data management practices.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
A very mild afternoon, a mix of sun and clouds, the high 69. Becoming cloudy tonight, the chance of a few scattered rain showers. Colder after midnight, the low 36. Tomorrow, cold and breezy, the sky mostly cloudy, the high 47. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 66 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Minutes away from Eldrick, Tiger Woods teeing off in the Genesis Open. Stands at plus one. So if you're in golf, that's going to be coming up here in just about, I don't know, about 10 minutes or so. You can watch my man Tiger Woods, see what he get done. Will he make the cut? I believe that this is his own personal tournament, too. So hopefully he'll do okay today. I know some scores early this morning was pretty good. The weather was par for the course. Guys were taking advantage of it. It was pretty calm, putting down some low numbers. So hopefully Tiger can get some things done on today. What about Caitlin Clark? Kudos to her becoming the all-time leading scorer. And that's pretty special. And her growth far as impact on women's basketball with Dawn Staley and South Carolina basketball, what they've been doing, all the attention that they're getting. Caitlin Clark, definitely a rock star of college women's basketball, going to be the first pick in the WNBA draft. So kudos to her. I think she shot that basketball when she broke the record from almost like half court, like Steph Curry-esque. I mean, it was amazing. So that girl can shoot from the gas station. She's pretty special. So kudos to her. A big weekend in Tuscaloosa. Just heard George talking about a little late celebration of Valentine's Day with him and his significant other. Then he's going to make the trip about 5, 6 in the morning, driving down to Coleman Coliseum. Big game for Alabama as they take on Texas A&M. The Aggies, really a surprising loss of Vanderbilt, but you know that they're looking to bounce back and beat the team that's in first place. That's Nate Oates and the Alabama Crimson Tide. So that game is at 11 a.m. Central Time. So that would be a good one. Should be a good basketball game. Also, baseball, Manhattan College, they got things going on around there and at the Joe. And then the softball, a doubleheader today. Just heard our good friend Tommy from Romulus. He's making his way, him and his brother, for the doubleheader. So Alabama, if you don't have anything to do this weekend, listen. What a weekend. I haven't looked at the weather, but I'm assuming it's going to be pretty good, right, Christian? Good days to be outside, watching some baseball, softball. Is it going to be cold, rain? Is that's in the forecast? I haven't looked.
Well, today there's like a 40% chance of showing. So we'll see about today, but I think Saturday and Sunday is supposed to be fine. It might be a little more chilly, kind of in the 50s, but, man, nonetheless, man, definitely a lot going on, which is good. Wyatt, do we have any app messages? I think we had two app messages. I think we had a few minutes. Let's hit those app messages real quick.
Yeah, this first one's from Kelly. Says, just a thought on the timing for Ryan Grubb. Chip Kelly was interviewed as well for the Seahawks, but it was announced on February 9th that he was going to Ohio State. The same day Grubb was announced as the offensive coordinator in Seattle. Maybe it was down to them two, and that Friday was the day Seattle gave them both their decision.
Great point. And see, that's why I say, I mean, like, listening to, you know, Ryan Grubb on that in that press conference, I mean, it appeared to me, he seems like a straightforward guy. He doesn't seem like he'd be trying to play the whole game. I mean, and then from what Kelly just said, that lines up where they probably were still going through the interview process. Now, do I believe that he had been talking with the Seahawks for a minute about that interest? Oh, yeah, definitely. But I think it's like he said, like he anticipated being in Tuscaloosa. His intentions were being here until otherwise. And then that otherwise is once they finally – tapped him as the offensive coordinator for the Seahawks. Is there a second one at message-wise?
Yeah, this is Rick from Ackworth. Corey, keep in mind Sheridan was the OC stint at Indiana, was with all those 4- and 5-star athletes, all that elite talent. With the school competing at the top of the Big Ten, knocking down conference championships and national championships. So that's a great way to analyze the new OC at Bama. And then he says, come on, bro, Christian, straighten out the old guy.
Yeah, look, I'm glad I got some people that aren't afraid to kind of help present this stuff to them. Because
so, I will say, because he didn't have 4- or 5-stars at Indiana.
But I think what they're saying is just if you to be open minded requires you to kind of think of variables like that. So when you're kind of more the glass half empty. You're kind of I'm not believing nothing till I see it. Even though you're a man of faith, which requires you to believe in something.
Well, that's
unseen.
Jesus, though. But Jesus is Jesus' perfection.
But if you have to have, but when you, with faith like that, I mean, you should practice that enough to know that there's other ways to have faith in people.
I don't put faith. The Bible tells me not to put faith in no man.
Absolutely. You're 100% right. But this is what we're saying. Yes. So there's always two sides to every story. There's always multiple perspectives. And what people want you to kind of start leaning into.
They should not want me. They should be comfortable in what they believe. I'm comfortable in what I believe.
Listen, nobody's saying that. Let me rephrase it. Stop getting offended. What it is
I'm not offended.
How do I explain this without you getting on your rocker? So, yes, you're right. And I go off of this crap, too. I mean, because that's the history. The history was the first year he did well. I think it was cut short, maybe because of COVID. I don't know, whatever it was. The next year, Next year, they were 2-10. They got fired. They had a number of injuries, I think, on the offensive line. The quarterback was hurt, which was Penix. So when you include that is something to consider. Now, does that mean, okay, that's exactly why he went 2-10 was fired? No, that's not the whole story. But that's something to consider. And then to the gentleman's point with the app message, you know, he's going to be under Coach DeBoer here. He wasn't with Coach DeBoer when he was OC at Indiana. Coach DeBoer left, I believe, and he was acting as offensive coordinator without him. So now you got Coach DeBoer overseeing him as a coordinator. He's going to be working with a lot of talented players. I think people are just saying, like, it could work out better than you might think if you only look at the 2-10. That and I agree with that. Now I will
say he got
say
fired in year number two.
He still did get fired. And again, if I'm being transparent, am I underwhelmed with him being the offensive coordinator at the University of Alabama, which is the mecca of college football, which we all know that, you know what I mean? Like, the standard here is different. Would I feel better about somebody more experienced, somebody that's a little more high profile? Absolutely.
Better resume.
Again, better resume. Yeah, just because, again, this is Alabama. Like, we deserve and should have the best.
Alabama, to me, is selling. I mean, right now, we're about to be called the Tuscaloosa Hoosiers. I mean, this is what, and everybody is accepting and not asking enough questions. Right? Ryan's getting ready to have, by the way, keep it locked right here on the Tide 100.9. Greg Byrne, athletics director of Alabama, will be on with him. Looking forward to that interview. Hopefully Ryan will throw some hard questions and don't let him off the hook with these softball. But here's my bottom line. Listen right here. The guy got fired. So here's the thing in this whole media point, right? A fan, wherever you at. I can be a fan and I can find and justify anything. I can look at it and paint it to where I feel good about the decision that Greg Byrne and Kalen DeBoer made about it. I can find that. I can sit here and pick something out and find that. I can take the approach of what you were saying. Or I can say, let's be honest, we don't know enough about this dude. What we have on the paper is he was fired in year number two. I can talk about injuries. I can talk about this, that, and the third. Because here is the freaking reality of it. If this was Auburn, if this was the Bulls, if this was Georgia, if this was somebody else with this staff, with this hiring, the same people that's offering all this stuff will be ripping the shreds with these coaching hires. One's on the radio, one's in the media. They will be saying awful things about what we're worried, we're this, we're y'all, look who y'all got. I know they would. So my point is, you said it all. It's Alabama. When the GOAT Coach Saban left, it's like we lowered our standards. And let's make ourselves feel good. I'm saying no. I'm saying I don't like it. I don't think it's great. I hope it is. And if it is, prove it. You're going to have a chance to prove it. Right? Then you'll have receipts. Right now, your receipts look bad. So what you got to do is prove it. You got
to
hire.
There are no receipts to look bad. Nobody's playing anything.
I know.
Anything.
You gotta, but no next year, I'm saying next year we'll have some receipts.
But you said your receipts look bad. That doesn't make sense. There's no receipts.
Yeah, based on what he's done. He was fired in year two. His resume as office coordinator doesn't look good. That's the receipts I'm going off of. So that's all I'm saying. But do I hope in the world that Corey Miller will eat freaking raw eggs, and this man is the best that ever been? I hope so for the University of Alabama. But as being real, as real, I don't know. It's pretty scary
still,
right
still
now.
You still kind of just disregarded my whole point of still saying, like, that there's naming the things that could go right.
Rock me.
I'm just going to look at the things that could go wrong. I'm not going to pay attention to anything that could go right because that's not keeping it real. You've been listening to the Miller's Edge right here on Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTVC. We appreciate all our listeners out there. We are the home of Alabama sports. Again, we are presented by the Good Feet Store, America's art support experts. Everybody have a great and safe weekend. See you guys Monday.